Ruiner is an amazing example of how an artist can combine so many different meanings, so many different emotional states and musical styles to create something really powerful and surprisingly cohesive. I hear elements of hip hop, metal, industrial, psychedelic rock, blues, and even more. And sometimes I feel like I'm being thrown around in a violent storm, and then the next second, I think I'm in a smoky bar. And yet this is such a graspable track. And there are some parallels, I think, between Ruiner and Mr. Self-Destruct, not just in the meaning, but in the song structure. Both are extremely intense and driving at almost exactly the same tempo, 115 beats per minute for Mr. Self-Destruct and 116 for Ruiner. But also the unforgiving, jarring transitions, the bridge where it just feels like the bottom falls out from underneath you, and the distorted, mangled vocals that maybe you can't always understand intellectually, but that you feel. So much character, so much bravado, so many different kinds of emotions. Let's start at the very beginning, because to me, this song has always started at the end of Closer. The last note of Closer, the piano, anticipates the beat of the beginning of Ruiner, meaning it comes just ahead of it. And Closer is sort of winding down like a music box, and it just feels like everything's slowing down, and then all of a sudden, how lovely it is to feel like everything's sort of slowing down, winding down. You're falling, falling, and then suddenly you just hit the ground. Like that place that we were heading at the very end of Closer, the downward spiral, the end. It's not over, but it was only temporary because there's more that this protagonist has to do. There's more to reject, there's more to ruin, there's more to destroy, there's so much farther to fall, and there's a lot more to lose. The hip-hop groove takes the center stage of the intro, but there are a couple other things happening musically that I kind of want to touch on before we get into the groove. And one of them sounds almost like a ghost of the broken piano from Closer. And it sort of sounds like it's fading away. Dun, dun. It's very subtly orienting us to our new key, which is A. Kind of. It sounds like it's a little bit sharp. I could be wrong and I could be going off the deep end, but it really does kind of sound to me like the actual A from Closer. It just, there are certain textures to it. There's also these screeching noises. I personally don't recognize that as anything meaningful, but I was trying to find out, like, what is this? You know, is it just like some kind of record scratch, or is it some tape that they sped up? Is it a sample of someone talking? It sort of sounds like, you know, when you would fast forward on a VHS tape during dialogue, you know. If I had to sort of rhythmatize it and play it on another instrument, I would probably have it go like this. And this is what it looks like with sheet music. Very syncopated. Almost all of those beats are represented by the kick drum in the hip hop groove. But that last one, that little last squeak, that's just on the offbeat right before the next downbeat. So it's like extremely syncopated, anticipating the beat just a little bit, and it's higher, so it's kind of accented. Anyway, I just always really liked the way that this was worked into the groove, and it repeats with every single measure until we get to the verse. So now let's talk about the hip hop groove itself. It's sampled from an Art of Noise song called Beatbox diversion one. I did not figure this out. I looked it up, and thank you to the Nine Inch Nails wiki. In the original, there are two measures in the intro before the bass line or any other tonality comes in, and he chose the second one. The kick has a lot of syncopation in the second measure, but I can also hear that there was some more syncopation added on top, almost like a different kick drum or an 808 or something. And another reason I'm mentioning this syncopation now is because it's going to become more important in contrast to what's going on in the chorus. But that'll come later. First, let's look at the verse. There's also an almost creepy, clicky hi-hat in the intro whose burst of 32nd notes sounds a bit like long nails clicking on hard plastic. So we have the same hip-hop groove in the verse, but now we have some synths. And of course we have Trent's vocals. Kind of starting from the ground up, let's look at the synth. So this synth is the first experience we have of any real tonality in the song, and it's not telling us a whole lot about what kind of A we're in, but it is showing us we're in A. It's also, though, showing us that there's some kind of harmonic movement being implied. It's basically a bass line, but it's not very low. And that's another reason why it doesn't feel super intense right away, is because we don't really have a very strong low end in the song yet. So if I slow it down, this is essentially what's happening. So first, kind of let's look at what's going on in the bottom of this synth. So we have A, F, D, and that is implying a harmonic progression. But here's one way that it could be heard.
You had all of them on your side, didn't you? Didn't you? You believed in all your lies, didn't you? Didn't you?
But we'll never really know because we're never given that level of information about the harmonic progression. We just get the bass line and we just get little hints from the vocals. But that's important. You don't want triads, I think, in this kind of song, at least not in this particular take on it, because it needs to be powerful. It shouldn't have that much like humanity to it, if that makes sense. Like having this is so much more forgiving than, and that is the tonic, and then it's a half step above it. So in the scale, that would be the flat two, but I don't really think that we should be thinking of this in terms of the scale degrees right now, because this sort of chromatic movement is repeated here and here. So it's more just like an embellishment. It's sort of this, it's just like a demented tone. You know, instead of being nice, it could have been like. Instead it's. That tightness, it's just so much more evil, to be honest. It just sounds like there's some darkness here. Like no matter where you go, it follows you. Now up here, we've got, and these notes are really important, the flat seven and the one. So I'm gonna talk about scale degrees now. One is the most important in any tonal music because that is our home base, that's our key, that's where everything feels settled. So we're gonna be hearing a lot of that, but we also hear a ton of the flat seven, and not just in this song, but in all of Trent Reznor's music. You've heard me talk probably about his love of minor sevenths and that flat seventh scale degree specifically. The way that he uses this flat seventh scale degree, I could probably do an entire thesis on. But for now, I'll just say that one of the ways he uses it is sort of to tonicize that A. This is one of his ways of telling us that we're an A. Like just the one below it, an excellent way, by the way, in your own music, to tonicize where you're at. If your music has some kind of an edge without using a sort of traditional cadence like 5-1, you could use 7-1. Works in major or minor. It's really awesome. Sometimes I run out of adjectives. Now, so these notes are a lot higher than these notes. It's an octave higher. So they stand out just because they're higher. They're just easier to perceive. But also they stand out because they are syncopated. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1. I don't know if you could hear, but those notes are falling on either side of me saying and. So they're like in the space in between. Now I can subdivide what I'm saying into 1E and a 2E and a, and then you'll hear them line up. 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a 1E and a 2E and a 3E and a 4E and a E, E, very syncopated. And even down here it's syncopated. 1. And then when we move to this note, that's even on an offbeat, meaning it's not on like one or and or anything like that. It's on one of the E and Us, one of the 16th note offbeats. So there's just all sorts of great syncopation, and we're going to talk more about that as we go through this video. So if you're ever stuck with something that you're like, I like this, but it just needs something new, try shifting something to an offbeat if you can. So other than that synth, the only other thing that's giving us tonality is his voice. So let's go there and see what he's doing. So to me, it sounds like he's singing in the minor hexatonic blues scale, which is like the minor pentatonic scale, but with a flat 5 added. Minor pentatonic. Hexatonic blues. That's our bluesy note. But there's another thing he does that's sort of bluesy, and that's that he sings minor thirds against major thirds, but that's coming later. At first, he's singing an octave lower, and his quality is very controlled. It's almost whispery, but he's definitely singing. I kind of hear, didn't you, a little bit of that.
You had all of them on your side, didn't you, didn't you?
I just love how he hits that last one. He really makes it obvious that he's going up. Didn't you? Kind of just like this whine to it. It's very, very expressive, going from the C to the D. Didn't you? It's so good.
Didn't you? Didn't you?
And I particularly love the line, "You believed in all your lies," because you might expect him to say, "I believed in all your lies." But it's you believed in all your lies. You've kept yourself in such denial. Now, before we move forward into the song, I do want to touch on what happens in the second verse, because there are some new layers that are introduced.
You had to give them all a sign. Didn't you? Didn't you? You had to cover what was mine.
So I'm hearing a new drum groove, and it's just the right kind of groove, because it sounds more like some kind of a rock groove, but it's not getting in the way of the hip-hop groove. The hip-hop groove is still able to be preserved. That syncopation is still there. But this one's a little more straightforward. It just sort of beefs it up a little bit. And it's not emphasizing the syncopated kick, but it's not overshadowing it. And since we were just talking about vocals, we also get a little background vocal.
You had to give them all a sign. Didn't you? Didn't you? Didn't you?
And that's so great, because it's also the tonic and the seventh. So we're getting that emphasized again. It's in his falsetto, and it reminds me a little bit of the falsetto in Mr. Self-Destruct, you know, just sort of a little bit demented, a little bit off. And it's kind of coming from over the shoulder, you know, like, didn't you? Listen to this beautiful vocal harmony, because it's actually a lot more than just him saying, didn't you?
You had to
to give them all a sign. Didn't you? But it evolves, right? Because it doesn't stay small for very long. When he sings Covet What Was Mine, maybe it's the same voice, maybe it's a different voice, but it kind of comes in from underneath and goes, you had to covet what was mine. And it really sounds pissed off. You know, it overtakes the protagonist or whoever's singing right now. And then what used to be this little falsetto turns into, didn't you? Oh! And it's just so angry. It's like it can no longer keep its cool. It has lost its shit. You know, maybe at first, the protagonist is standing back and just sort of feeling this sense of disgust and mocking, like, you thought that you had them all fooled, didn't you? To being like, how dare you? You know? And there's so much self-righteousness, I feel like, that kind of wells up and explodes. There is another sound, a synth, that comes in on the second verse. And I think it could possibly be a nod to March of the Pigs. Listen to this. It's really chromatic, it's ascending, and everything's sort of happening against this tonic A up top. So there's sort of this like convergence. And everything is sort of alternating with that A. That's kind of what's happening in the bass line in March of the Pig. And it is a very similar ascending chromatic alternating situation. Again, this could just be coincidence. It could just be something that Trent likes to do, a trendency, but I don't know. This is such an intentional. I'm sorry, I have a problem. I love how this section sounds almost like the verse, but distorted to hell. You can hear that the drums themselves sound way bigger, fatter, more distorted, messier, clashier, smashier, and his vocals have changed from sort of this low, like, to something that sounds kind of inhuman. Now, I've been calling it a scream rap because I thought he was maybe screaming, but now that I've been able to isolate the channels, check this out. This could be a case of wishful hearing. He might be kind of yelling on a flat seven, on the flat seven of the scale. The ruiner's a collector, he's an infector. At least that's kind of how I sing along to it in the car. But that would be an understandable note for him to sort of pick or yell. And then, you know, at the very end when he says, and maybe that fucked me up much more than you'll ever know, he kind of abandons that higher yell to dig down deep. And maybe that fucked me up so that he can crescendo. My subscribers have commented that this is probably the result of ring modulation. So thank you for helping me start to pick this out in the album. And maybe it's just that alone that sort of covers up the consonants in the more clean delivery, or maybe it's just some mixing genius from Adam Mulder, but either way, it's very challenging to hear what he's saying. I feel like it's a little bit easier to hear what he's saying in the second pre-chorus. What always came through to me were bits and pieces of words, but mostly it was the rhythm and it was the delivery. It was like the emotion and the accents. So there's just a lot of rhythmic brilliance, I think, in this kind of rap. It's very syncopated. It kind of does fit in with the hip-hop groove, but it's so messed up. Something we can sort of recognize as fitting with something that feels really uncomfortable and out of place. Ruiner's got a lot to prove. He's got nothing to lose, and now he made you believe. So just like so much syncopation. A lot of 16th note offbeats. But then he contrasts that with periods where it's just straight eighth notes. Like in the second pre-chorus where he's saying, "And maybe that fucked me up much more than you'll ever know." Those are just straight on the eighth notes. And those sections stand out as a result. The emotional impact of going from something that's so syncopated like that. Ruiner's got a lot to prove, he's got nothing to lose, and you know, and then it's just like, maybe that screwed me up forever. Quick little detour to the demo of this song on the deluxe version of the album. And you can hear that he's actually singing it, still kind of buried in the mix, like he didn't want it to be super obvious, but it doesn't have the same power, so I'm really glad that they chose to go with this version. Now, I made an accidental discovery, could also just be a coincidence, but it sounds to me like maybe a drum track from I Do Not Want This, but it's really, really buried. Take a listen. Okay, now the chorus. This bold synth comes in. It's so strident. It's actually quite thin. It almost sounds like a synthesized horn or something, but it still sounds so powerful. And whenever this synth kind of barged in, it always sounded to me like, ah, this is the Ruiner's theme. Oh my gosh, this chorus just always hits me like a ton of bricks. And it's a combination, I think, of just the kick on the downbeats. It's just so like, I am relentless, I'm unforgiving, no syncopation for you. And then these two melodic themes. So we've got that one, but we also have... both so good in such different ways. So this horn sound that I was talking about, it sounds to me like it doesn't have a perceivable attack or delay. And it's also very dry. There really isn't any reverb on it or a delay or anything. So it's just really in your face. It sounds like it's right there. It's all around you. And it's totally unforgiving. Starting on the fifth degree, going up to the flat six, to the flat seven. So we're kind of like, we're like going up the scale, starting on the fifth degree, but we don't get all the way up to the top. So before we get to the top, we drop down to the fourth, which is a kind of an unstable, very open sounding, ancient sounding interval, in my opinion, resolving to the major third. That kind of resolution, doesn't it make you feel better? It just makes you feel better. So why put that at the end of this theme? I'm not sure, but to me it always did add a little bit of some kind of humanity to this theme, which otherwise would sound mostly mechanical or like a huge monster or something that was subhuman or superhuman. This is a really good melody because you've got both stepwise motion, then you've got a nice jump here, and you've got a resolution. Trent Reznor's use of the major third scale degree is really quite prolific, and mostly that note is associated with major scales and joy and comfort, but he uses it in a completely different way. Not to say he sometimes doesn't use it in the more traditional way or to bring hope, but I feel like in the downward spiral especially, for the most part, he's been using it in sort of a way to describe mania and insanity and mocking and irony. You know, it's just, it doesn't mean what you think it means. And because it doesn't really fit, it really stands out. As far as I can tell, there aren't other major thirds, and not in his vocals and not in this. So again, this is all intentional. When I hear this, that feels so powerful, feels so ancient. Feels so big. But then this, it feels like that doesn't belong. And yet I feel good. So I feel conflicted. And so now I feel tense when normally I would feel relieved. And he emphasizes even more when he goes the second time. He goes up to that major third again, an octave higher. And so it's, you can't ignore it. There are some big changes between the Ruiner demo and the final version on the studio album, like the drums and the verse, but I want to bring your attention to a very small change that I think had a big impact, big enough to change it. If you listen to the horn synth, what I call the Ruiner theme, there is a syncopation in the demo, an anticipation of the third note. This was changed to fall on the downbeat instead in the studio version. Without asking Trent, I won't know why, but one theory is that the syncopation humanized this theme too much, like it somehow took away its mechanical and brutal power. If a major third instead of a minor third, which is just a half step apart, can change the entire emotional landscape of a melody, so can an eighth note. Now this one, unlike the other one, has a minor third in it. This also has some stepwise motion, it also has some big jumps, and it has just the right amount, I think, of tension and release, tension and release. So we have rest, tension, rest, tension, tension, rest, that's the fifth, down to the tonic. Now let's look underneath these top layers, because there are some other interesting things happening. Mostly just the octave with the occasional dip down to that flat seven, again, tonicizing A. But you'll also notice there were some rests. It wasn't just straight 16th notes the whole time, and those rests end up becoming rhythmic in and of themselves just because everything else surrounding them is so consistent. When you stop, it brings it out. So the silence ends up becoming a rhythm. One, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one E and a, there we go. One E and a, two E and a, three E and a. We don't get beats two and four, basically. They are negative space, and that creates syncopation. So as I mentioned, the drums here are very important. There's no groovy syncopation here. It's just this relentless kick on the downbeat and some other accents. And I always imagined it being like shattering glass or something really destructive. But as I was listening to it more, I could also picture like a shovel, like. So these accents are interesting because they're on beats one and three. Those remind me of a halftime groove. How'd you get so big? Like that kind of thing, which just makes me think of like a big, yeah, another monster or something that's superhuman, and it's just, you know, or it's stalking its prey. Meanwhile, we have this like pulsating kick, you know, like a fast heartbeat or something. It's just, you get so many levels, I feel, of emotion just from the rhythms alone. Just the sludgier I feel the rhythms, the slower they are, the more menacing they feel, at least in this context. Now let's go back to this theme. Because I noticed that the vocal melody kind of follows that same pattern. Not exactly. How'd you get so big? So it's not really until this note, big, that they kind of match up. How'd you get so strong? How'd... He's just a little ahead. How'd it get so hard? There we go. How'd it get so long? So I guess I can just make an argument that maybe that vocal melody kind of came out of the Ruiner melody, or maybe it was the other way around, which you could take to an extreme in symbolism. At first, the narrator is doing its own thing, and then it's following the Ruiner. So the first part of his vocal melody sounds like it has a lot of tension in it, and the second one is more the resolution. Listen to how it sounds without the Ruiner theme underneath it. So the first part is not very stable. We do have the fifth in there, but the note that's really being emphasized is the fourth. Almost like everything's just sort of dancing around the fourth. Then, resolution. Home. Also, who loves how he sings long? How'd it get so long?
How'd it get so hard? How'd it get so long?
He sounds disgusted. He sounds like he's in admiration. There's just so many different emotions. And that's really how I feel about this whole chorus and what it means, because there are so many ways to interpret this. He's leaving it so open-ended for us by just saying you and it. I mean, we don't even know really who you is, and we certainly don't know what it is. I'm sure you have your own opinion on what it is. And you might think, well, it's obvious, but I don't think it's obvious. I think that this chorus could have multiple meanings. So even though in the first chorus he's singing an octave lower, and then in the second he's singing an octave higher, and he has that sort of chorus extension and what you gave to me, my perfect ring of scars, both times the vocals are, I'm pretty sure, panned really hard to the left. They sound buried, but they also sound like they're inside of your head. It's really brilliant. When he sings, "And what you gave to me, my perfect ring of scars," he goes up to the flat 7. 5th, 7th. My perfect ring of scars. Kind of an ambiguous 3rd, I'm not really sure. You know I can say what you really are. Also similar to how he sings long. What you really are. It's just so twisted and menacing sounding. In the second chorus, a new bass line is introduced, like a premonition of the end of the song. This is one of the thematic ties that keeps the song cohesive, in my opinion. We actually get to move up here. So this is the flat five and the flat three. So this is, again, this is the tritone in the scale. This is a very bluesy sound. And it just sounds very menacing. It's not a very forgiving chord progression. I don't think Trent Reznor realized how beloved this guitar solo was going to be. I don't think really anybody did. And it just comes right out of the blue. Literally, it's a blues solo. My favorite parts of the solo are the parts where Trent is bending the string. So he's kind of making it a very expressive, almost vocal sounding instrument. And he's going outside of the normal scale degrees to add a lot of expression. So there's two points where that happens really obviously. But it's just kind of sliding up. So my other favorite part is when he goes kind of up this run, up the blues scale, and he gets to his highest note, which sounds almost like an A, but it sounds a little sharp. So I think he's bending the string, and it's somewhere in between these notes. It's not a full-on B flat, but it's definitely not an A. Something right in between, but whenever I'm doing air guitar, I can't not wait for that part. It always had a lot of swagger to me, so there was just some bravado, some like overconfidence about it. I mentioned that the guitar solo is improvising on the blues scale. So here are the notes of the blues scale that we've been talking about, and here's a rough rundown of the notes used in the guitar solo without any sort of pitch bending. If you play an instrument, chances are you've improvised on this scale before, or at least on the pentatonic scale. You really can't go wrong with it. It's just so foundational. The guitar sometimes seems like it's screaming, but it's not the only sound that reminds me of a scream, because this sample detonates on beat two of every measure in the second half of the bridge. I wonder if this inspired that slightly disturbing high note in his guitar solo that I was gushing about. Now, there's something supporting the guitar solo, and that's an actual progression, harmonic progression. Sounds to me like we're going to the flat three, the flat seven, to the four, to the one, then flat three, and then just sort of this chromatic stepwise downward spiral. The other sound that we're hearing, especially at the beginning of the bridge before the guitar comes in, is sort of what I would call like tonal ghostly wind. It might seem silly to you to apply any sort of music theory concept to that sound, but I've always sung them. So I was always searching for a pitch, and it sounds to me like they're sort of starting on the tonic, going up to the flat two, and then kind of ending on the flat seven. And those are two notes that are definitely in whatever scale we're sort of existing in, you know, here. It sounds creepy to me because it reminds me of wind in scary movies where you're like not sure if it's the wind or if it's a ghost. And they're like, no, it's just the wind. If you listen closely to the end of this ghostly wind, you can tell that it's a sample of something. Maybe it's just been pitched down or slowed down from like a movie, especially at the very end. Listen. And then there's also this sort of like I don't know, like a machine sound, like a machine winding down, or maybe chains or something else that doesn't sound comfortable. Ch, 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 ch. And it's kind of out of time. It doesn't sound very rhythmic, but it is. It's repetitive. Really appreciate the way that Trent finds rhythmic and tonal meaning in samples that normally wouldn't be perceived that way. And then he showcases that in his songs. You didn't hurt me, nothing can hurt me. You didn't hurt me, nothing can stop me now. Almost like a mantra. At first it sounds kind of powerful to me, you know, where he's like, you didn't hurt me, nothing can hurt me. I'm invincible, I'm all powerful, I'm omnipotent. But then it starts to sound a little more desperate to me because his voice gets a little more shaky sounding and his inhales get more intense, almost rhythmically. You didn't hurt me. Nothing can hurt me. You didn't hurt me. And he just seems like he's unraveling, kind of like the guitar solo at the end. This mantra is starting to sound more like something he's trying to convince himself of. And like I said, there's just so many ways to interpret this whole song and even this section. Who is narrating? Who is he talking to? Because I could make an argument that it's not really the protagonist saying this. So if you listen with headphones, you'll hear that these repetitions of the mantra alternate from the left and right channels. It's giving you that feeling of these like voices or these other parts of him that are coming in. And that line, nothing can stop me now, that's coming back from Piggy. But this time, it feels like it has a different meaning. It's not as careless sounding. Whether or not in Piggy you feel that he was saying, nothing can stop me now, or nothing can stop me from dying or killing myself. Either way, there was sort of this, yeah, like, because I don't care anymore kind of thing. And now it feels like he does care. And by the last repetition, he stops on the word stop. And I mean, it stops. There is no data whatsoever. It's just over.